So, thank you very much for inviting me to the organizers. I have just a suggestion at the beginning, before my talk. Here, I guess it's in this circle is quite a lot of interest for cosmology. It's also one of my principal research fields. And in the previous, Neven has shown a nice overview over modern cosmology, and maybe some of the next meetings could be dedicated to cosmological problems, because we philosophers, we have also quite a lot to say about cosmology, not only about the old ancient cosmologies, but also about modern cosmology. This point is somehow not quite clear what philosophy has to do in cosmology, but as I think and as I believe, philosophy is...
Please use the microphone, put it just in front of
you. Well, yes, yeah. Philosophy has much to do with cosmology, and maybe one of the next meeting could be about that. So that's the theme of my talk today.
Put it near your mouth.
Well, but it's disturbing for me, sorry. Well. I will keep my time. I will not go over 45 minutes. I hope even less to remain some minutes for discussion, because we all are waiting for our coffee, of course. Well, my paper, my talk is philosophical, of course, because I'm a philosopher. But it has to do also with physics. My talk of today is more an overview of some problems concerning time in some recent philosophical theories concerning time. So it's not so much a research contribution, but more discussion about some questions which open in this field between physics and philosophy. It will be a talk also without formulas. However, it doesn't mean that formulas are not behind these problems. Of course, they are. And the third point is that I want really to contribute to some kind of collaboration between physics and philosophy. And the problem of time is particularly convenient, I think, for this purpose. So my main presentation will be some theories concerning some modern, recent theories concerning time. I'm quoting in some quotations from this book. It's a handbook. Oxford Handbook of Philosophy of Time. If somebody is interested, he or she can look at the book after the lecture, after the paper. But I will begin with classics. So my first couple of citations will be of Aristotle and Plato and Augustine, but I will go relatively quickly through, because I suppose that you are acquainted with these things. Well, you all know that Aristotle was the beginner of the analytic philosophy of time. He was not the beginner of time philosophy in general. There were pre-Socratics before who considered time, as we heard yesterday. But Aristotle, in his physics, in his fourth book of physics, chapters 10 to 14, has developed in a relatively short chapter practically the whole, as far as questions are concerned, not just answers, because answers, as far as followed much later, but he opened the main questions, philosophical, and at that time, of course, also physical questions concerning time. And of course, his principal question was, I won't read all these quotations, does time exist at all? This is a legacy also of his teacher Plato, of course. In some sense, we know that Aristotle was a critic of his teacher, but anyway, this question concerning the very existence of time versus eternity or versus no time has something to do with the legacy of Platonism in Aristotle's thought. His main question at the beginning was, does it belong to the class of things that exist or to that of things that don't exist? Passages are underlying are mine. It is not surely not in the original. And secondly, he continues, what is its nature, the nature of time? Because one suspects that it either doesn't exist or at all or barely and in an obscure way. One part of it has been and is not, while the other is going to be and is not yet. Past and future times, of course. And then I omit some sentences in between. One would naturally suppose that what is made up of things which don't exist could have no share in reality. And in the same passage, there is opened a question of now. When it exists, all or some part of time exists. But what is now is not a part. That is one of the main points of Aristotle, because he compares now with a point in geometry, in space. A part is a measure of the whole, he says, but which must be made of parts. Time, on the other hand, is not held to be made of now. So we will come back in a while to the conception of now. But anyway, Aristotle, as we all know, formulated this famous definition of time as a number or measure of motion. In Aristotle physics, time is essentially connected with motion, conceived in a very broad way, like more, it's more like change in today's terms, in Greek kinesis. That is with change, physical and or mental change as well. And he says, time doesn't exist without change. And here is the famous Aristotle's definition of time, which you probably all know. When we do perceive a before and an after, then we say that there is time. For time is just this, number of motion in respect to before and after. And then there's a discussion, what is the relation between time and number? Number is the concept in the very definition of time. So Aristotle is developing the theory about this relation between time and number. And he says time then is a kind of number. What is counted, time obviously is what is counted, not that which we count. It's in sense of his analytical philosophy, especially physics, and of course he was a great and the first logician in the history of philosophy. So it's very important that time is connected with movement, with change, and that another repeated definition, time is a measure of motion. That is so-called natural or physical or external definition of time, which was later in the history of philosophy put into contrast with the internal or intentional concept of time, which was more developed by Platonists and in the modern times in 20th century by phenomenology and other branches of philosophy. So we can say that Aristotle is the founder of the concept which we call now natural time or time, cosmological time, external time, objective time, or whatever you want, because he connected time with number, and he was the first. Well, we also have in Plato some passage of this connection with time with number, but not so explicit as in Aristotle, of course. And in the last quotations in this slide, there's also it's his point that the number is not only the measure of motion, but it's also the measure of rest. It doesn't mean that all things are in time. There are metaphysical entities which are perhaps not in time, but these things which are in rest, also their time is measured by other things which are in motion. A very important point concerning Aristotle's theory of time is its relation with the soul, with rational soul, especially the conception of now. And it opens an important philosophical question formulated by Aristotle already. The now, which seems to bound the past and the future, does it always remain one and the same, or is it always other and other? It's hard to say, comments Aristotle. I would add here, because if you continue the reading of this chapter, actually the now is both, already Aristotle, the same and another. And here is a very interesting passage concerning this identity of now. Just as motion is a perpetual succession, so also is time. But every simultaneous time is self-identical, for now as a subject, hypokeimenon in Greek, is an identity, but it accepts different attributes. It means different times as past, future, and present. The now measures time insofar as time involves before and after. The now, in one sense, is the same, in another, is not the same. Well, but of course, here the main philosophical problem is, what is this hypokeimenon? What is this subjectum of the moving and also of the sameness and also of the otherness of now? And if we read on, we can see that it is the soul, psyche in Greek, or more accurately, the reason in Latin anima rationale, the highest aspect of the soul in Aristotle. And we can say, well, it's not so explicitly said that the hypokeimenon of now is the soul, but it's implicit, and we can deduce it from the following passage. I will not read it the whole. He says, how time can be related to the soul? And he, in the end, he concludes that, but if nothing but soul, a reason is qualified to count, there would be no time unless there were soul. That's important to read and to take into account, because usually the history of philosophy is rather, let's say, schematic. And it puts Aristotle on the way of objective time, cosmological, physical time, and on the other hand, the Platonic tradition, and then Kant and phenomenology in modern times, on the other side, on the side of time of the soul, or time, this internal time in phenomenology, in Husserl, for example, and so on. But it's not so simple. Aristotle, it is already this distinction and this connection, let's say, between soul or the subject of counting of the number, which is in the definition of time, is very, very present in his philosophy. I will just. It's a marvelous jewel in Timaeus, but I will just quickly go over where Plato defines time as an image of the eternity, because the demiurge, uh, the creator of the world in this famous and very rich dialogue of Plato, one of the late dialogues, as you know, Timaeus, in this dialogue, the demiurge is the creator of the world, and he couldn't give eternity to the created world. That's why he gave to the world the image of eternity, and this image, this eternal image, but which is moving according to number, is the time, while eternity itself rests in unity. This image we call time, aiona, eikona aionis in Greek, so time is a moving image of eternity in Plato's tradition. St. Augustine put his famous question, which we have already seen as one of the quotations in colleague Dragan's talk yesterday, and this question is, what is actually time? And the famous point is, what then is time? If no one asks me, I know, but if I wish to explain it to one, then ask it, I don't know. Yet I say boldly that I know that if nothing passed away, time past were not, and if nothing were coming, a time to come were not, and if nothing were, time present were not. However, in spite of this, let's say, skepticism about the possibility of answering the question, what is time, St. Augustine finds his answer to this question in his Confessions, this famous passage, some chapters below, continues, there will be three times, a present of things past, a present of things present, and a present of things future. For these three times do exist in some sort in the soul, wrote St. Augustine, but otherwise I don't see them. Present of things past, memory. Present of things present, sight. Present of things future, expectation. So out of the soul, three flowers of time grew in connection with three capacity of the soul: memory, sight, and expectation. Now we'll go to the main topic of my talk today, to some problems in, or to some points in the modern philosophical theories of time. We may say that if we try to take the main aspects of the classical reality of time, we may put three main points here. Time is real. Now, I know this reality here is rather undefined, but in the classical way, let's say, time is real if the present moment now is somehow substantially distinguished from other moments, from past and future. Secondly, if time has an intrinsic direction, the term here is usually in the modern philosophy of time of 20th century, following Reichenbach and Adolf Grünbaum, anisotropy of time. If anisotropy of time obtains, then time is something real as a second, let's say. These are not just maybe necessary conditions, but something quite close to necessary conditions of the reality of time. And thirdly, if passage or flux is the essential property of time. So these three classical as well as intuitive criteria for the reality of time are taken from Hugh Price, from one of the authors in this handbook, which you have also in the slide, on the slide. However, I have slightly modified some notions, so it's not the exact quotation of Hugh Price. Price uses in all three cases, that means for now, direction and passage, the word objective, objectively. However, he tacitly presumes that ontological objectivity is equivalent or is supposed to be equivalent with physical reality. But to my mind, this presumption is at least questionable. Price argues against passage of time because he's a later we shall see one of the followers of the so-called B theories of time. Following here, Hugh Mellor, his professor in Cambridge, he was, Price was doctor student of Mellor, and disputes on this issue also with Tim Modlin. I have prepared some discussion with Tim Modlin, but he is this year not here, so I will omit this discussion and go on in these topics. So, in modern philosophical discussions about time, it's important, the important moment is, of course, McTaggart. As you know, you probably, all of you heard about McTaggart's paradox of time, and he distinguished between A series and B series of events in time. In his famous article, The Unreality of Time, in the 1908, he distinguished these two different serial orders of events in time. A series are series of positions which run from the far past through the near past to the present, and then from the present through the near future to the far future. That's a quotation from McTaggart. And B series are series of positions which run from earlier to later, series of events, of course. It's quoted from this handbook, which I shortly refer as Time in Italics. The properties of being past, being present, and being future are called the A properties, and the relations take care, nota bene, here A properties and B relations, they are not B properties, but B relations. The relations being earlier than, being later than, and being simultaneous with are called B relations. The ordering of events in B series doesn't require neither a present moment now, nor the passage of time, the flux of time, while the ordering in A series presupposes both. And now just shortly, I'm also, I think that you know the famous McTaggart's paradox of time. I put into brackets paradox. I personally, I think that it's not at all a paradox, but it's some aporia, let's say, which was important like Zeno paradoxes in the antiquity. It triggered very fruitful and broad discussion about concerning the nature of time. But similar, analogous, as we know that Achilles would overtake the tortoise, in the similar way we can say about McTaggart's paradox of time or his argument that the time exists not. Well, it's just following Hugh Price because it's summarized, this paradox here. I have written quite a lot of years ago a paper about McTaggart's paradox. You can find it on my homepage on the internet in English. Well, there are three premises in this paradox. The first premise, there is no time without change. The second premise, the real change requires that events change with respect to the properties of pastness, presentness, and futurity. That means events begin in the as future and come to us, become present, and then past. This means, as a corollary, combined with the premise one, that only A series, not B series, are adequate for the ordering of events, if time is supposed to be real. And the whole point of this argument, McTaggart's point, is that time is not real. And the third premise is these properties of pastness, presentness, and futurity cannot be real, for they are incoherent. Each event must have all three, and they have, and they are contradictory. Well, I don't see here a genuine contradiction, but that's not the main point of my discussion today. That I should have another half an hour or even more to discuss it. So we go on. So the conclusion of this McTaggart's paradox is: the time doesn't exist since its very essence is contradictory. As I said, I think that no one really believes in the sense of the validity of this argument of McTaggart, but it triggered a big debate in modern, let's say, 20th century analytic. Underline here analytic philosophy of time, because sometimes we just forget that there's not just analytic philosophy on the stage, especially in circles where the majority of people who discuss are from the American American circles or British Anglo-Saxon tradition. Sometimes it's forgotten that we have a very, very strong other philosophies of time, so-called continental, let's say, that it's phenomenology, it's existentialism, it's many other branches. So, well, I don't go into those at the moment, but I would like to stress that analytical philosophy of time, it's not just the philosophy of time. The only one philosophy of time. You have several. But inside this analytical philosophy of time, there is a big debate, there was a big debate, and is still going on among followers of A series and followers of B series, and this dispute goes on in academic circles, if I may say, nearly ad infinitum. A theorists here, there are very known names, of course, very interesting philosophers and also scientists. Some of them are enumerated here below in this passage. And I'm also in some way, if I should decide, if it would necessary to decide between A theorists and B theorists of time, I would be rather more inclined to E theorists with some reserve. Well, but it's also not enough time to explain these reserves. The main ideas of A theorists are that time is tensed. In English, there's a very fruitful difference between time and tense. That the reality of passage of time is something, the passage of time is something real, and that the moving now is something real, and that there is essential difference between past and future times. On the other hand, you have B theorists. Here on the right, you have a famous, already classical dispute in a book which was edited by Oaklander and Smith. Smith as an A theorist, Oaklander as B theorist of time. And main ideas is tenseless time. Tense and tenseless, it has, of course, connection with proposition, which refer to some time events in the language, but that's also a new topic which should be treated separately. Four-dimensional block universe following Einstein's theory of relativity, no real passage of time, the moving now is just an illusion, and so on. And I won't read the famous names. You can see yourself that on both sides there are very famous names from philosophical and also scientific world. So, just in, let's say, in the contemporary analytic philosophy, the theories of time are, of course, still influenced by these discussions between A and B theorists. This discussion is still going on also in this handbook, Oxford Handbook of Philosophy of Time, However, this discussion is more ramified concerning the question of the reality of time. Generally speaking, there are three main groups here. The first group are so-called eternalists. They believe that the past, present, and future are all real, following the four-dimensional space-time block universe, so-called block universe, and B theory of time. The second group are so-called possibilists, believe the past and present are real, but the future is not, and that is, of course, a way for, or an argument for indeterminism concerning the future events. And the third main group are presentists. They believe that only the present is real, is emphatically real, let's say, and they hold that the moving now is something substantial. What is this substance of the moving now is, there are different answers, but that something substantial, something ontologically real. So these presentists mainly follow a theories of time. But there are also several intermediate variants here, several combinations of the relation between block of space-time and the moving now. Here just a short look from its diagram from this handbook. So for example, five groups here are mentioned in this, that is in the text of Barry Dainton, time, passage, and immediate experience, block universe, moving spotlight, this conception of spotlight, I will come back soon to this concept, growing block not just here all the time, but growing block with a glowing edge, so present is something actually different from the past, and the last, so here you have mainly this two main extreme positions. On the top here is a block universe, and in the other end of the scale is presentism. In the following, I will discuss very briefly, of course, this opposition between eternalism and presentism, and I have to leave because of it's not enough time. But there are other variants, combinations are quite extensively discussed in this handbook and also in many books which are connected with this topic, are also, of course, interesting, but I will just present shortly this this debate between eternalists and presentists. So now we are here. We are in our discussion between philosophy and physics. It's very strange and also in something marvelous that physics with Einstein became the proponent of eternalism. That is something not so normal for the relation between physics and philosophy in the history. Usually philosophy was, on the philosopher's side, was argumentation for eternity and so. And here we have, in after Einstein, we have some eternalism also which is influent, radiating from physics to philosopher's field and discussions. One of the very interesting quotations, which wasn't already mentioned in this meeting, was Einstein's famous letter of condolence to the family of his deceased friend, one of his best friends, Michele Besso, in 55. That was some months before Einstein's own death, where Albert Einstein wrote his famous quote, "Now he," namely Michele, "has departed from this strange world a little ahead of me." That means nothing. says Einstein. People like us who believe in physics know that the distinction between past, present, and future is only a stubbornly persistent illusion. Well, you can say that it's maybe just a letter of condolence, some nice words and so, but it, Einstein was not a man who would just say something for a form. It was also meant in a way he stand behind these words. Of course, we know because of the conception of block universe and so on. It's interesting to note that a similar belief, but in this case with a slight flavor of presentism, was expressed some years before in 1948 by Hermann Weyl. Let's read also this quotation. The objective world simply is, it doesn't happen. Only to the gaze of my consciousness, crawling upward along the lifeline of my body, does a section of this world come to life as a fleeting image in space which continuously changes in time. My gaze of my consciousness crawling upward along the lifeline in the block universe, we may say, which is behind this this imagination. Michael Lockwood, one of the followers of B theorists and also philosopher who is enthusiastic about relativistic conception of space-time, in his quite well-known book, The Labyrinth of Time, wrote the following. Here, this opinion is maybe more explicit or clearly explained or clearly expressed, like in rather metaphorical speech of Einstein and Weyl on this point. So Lockwood says the following, writes, to take the space-time view seriously is indeed to regard everything that ever exists or ever happens at any time or place as being just as real as the contents of the here and now. That's a very surprising proposition, because if I may illustrate it in a simple example, for example, it's to believe that some event which took place 10 or 100 or 1,000 years ago is in the same sense here and now as, for example, Sydney in Australia. Sydney in Australia is let's say Andromeda galaxy. We don't doubt into the reality of Sydney in spite of the fact that we are far from Sydney now in space, or we don't doubt in the reality of the Andromeda galaxy which we see through the telescope. But should we doubt about the real existence of, let's say, some battle at Hastings, let's say, in 1066, I think, is it really here or not? Of course, this is an important question, and this question casts light on the question concerning space and time. And the extreme author here, as some of you know, surely, is Julian Barbour. In his controversial book, The End of Time, he argues for the extreme negation of the reality of time through the relativity theory and block universe, not so much through logic like McTaggart, but through mostly through physics. Now, on the other hand, you have presentism. I have still 5 minutes or something, yeah. In defense of presentism, one of the, let's say, leading contemporary presentists, which has also quite a large paper in this handbook, is Dean Zimmermann. That is, of course, in this analytic metaphysics of time. You can find presentism, in other branches of philosophy, especially in phenomenology and other branches of non-analytic philosophy. Zimmermann has written an apology of presentism in this book titled Presentism and the Space-Time Manifold, where he argues that presentism, as well as the A theory of time, is compatible with the theory of relativity. Because most critics of A theories think that this theory of relativity, which is well founded in physics and experimentally verified and so on, is not compatible with E theories of time. Here, Zimmermann argues that it's not the case, that the theory of relativity is, in fact, compatible with E theory of time and with moving now and with passage of time and so on. I want to read all the quotation. Presentism is the view that all of reality is confined to the present. It's a kind of definition of presentism. And we may say that this conception seems to be a kind of modern variant of St. Augustine's conception of time as distentio animae in Latin, into all three times, past, present, and future. However, Zimmermann's secular, let's say secular variant of ancient wisdom is more concerned to be compatible with modern physics than to take into account the metaphysical and or psychological in a genuine sense, psychological, psyche, in Greek, understanding of time. Now, moving spotlight view. The conception of present now as a moving spotlight, implicit also in Weyl's conception of time, which I quoted before, mentioned before, is common to some eternalists on the one hand and to some presentists on the other hand. However, their interpretations of the ontological reality of the presence of consciousness, figured as a moving spotlight which travels or glides, as in Weyl's terms, along the universal block of space-time, are different. For eternalists and or B theorists, it's just an illusion, while for the presentists, it's more real, at least as an epiphenomenon. The term is comes from the cognitive science or cognitive philosophy, philosophy of mind, not reducible to the physical reality. The image of this moving spotlight, which is many times repeats in recent literature, is due to C.D. Broad, to the famous English philosopher, who already in 1923 wrote the following metaphor. We are naturally tempted to regard the history of the world as existing eternally in a certain order of events. Along this, and in a fixed direction, we imagine the characteristic of presentness as moving somewhat like the spot, as moving somewhat like the spot of light from a policeman's bull's eye traversing the fronts of the houses in a street. What is illuminated is the present, what has been illuminated is the past, and what has not yet been illuminated is the future. So the figure of consciousness which moves and defines the moving now like a moving spot of light over the block universe of space-time. Well, this analogy of moving spotlight of the present now with moving spotlight falls to my mind fails in the most important aspect. If now is essentially connected with consciousness, that is with psyche as its subject of identity, hypokeimenon, if we paraphrase Aristotle, so as a theorist of time mostly believe, then it is not enough that consciousness just glides over the world as a spotlight. Since consciousness is much more, it is actively present in the world, it permanently constitutes, if I may here use Kant's term, the evolving space-time. It penetrates into the block universe and co-creates it. Surely consciousness is not just an illusion, and neither is time. The question of time, I'm coming to the conclusion, just one or two slides more, some minutes more. The question of time is time's unreality cannot be separated from the question of the reality of consciousness. That's my conviction, my belief. And what does it mean? This means that the answer of the so-called enigma of time, which is the main topic of my talk today, has to be primarily, not only, but primarily sought in the fields of cognitive science, phenomenology, anthropology, and basically in the ancient and modern, I would say, evergreen metaphysics. It doesn't mean that to exclude physics from the conception of time, not at all, but I think that metaphysics could never be reduced to physics, neither articulated within physics, as was the formulation of Tim Modlin. And the question if physics actually needs time as we experience it, this question is very reasonable. It's not just a superfluous question, it's a reasonable question. Why? Since time as an abstract variable t seems to satisfy all physical theories and purposes. However, passage of time is meaningful only for consciousness. Well, the last slide. Take consciousness seriously. As David Chalmers, the modern philosopher from Australia, very famous with his book, The Conscious Mind, claims, we have to take consciousness seriously. And I would add, this is necessary condition just for understanding, if not for solving the enigma of time. But just only for understanding the enigma of time, we have to take consciousness seriously. However, a question remains open here: if Chalmers himself takes, or took in his seminal book, The Conscious Mind, consciousness seriously enough. I think that consciousness has to be taken even more seriously, not just as a Cartesian point of self-certainty, cogito, as Chalmers claims, but as a field of evidence, following, let's say, Husserl's phenomenology, and more, as a Platonic mind which emanates from the good. And here is my final, let's say, mystical point. Eternity is hidden not only in the timeless block universe, as Einstein and his followers thought, but also in the fleeting moment, in the so-called kairos, as the Greeks would say, in the nunc stans, in the eternal now. Einstein surely knew also this mystery of transcending time, of transcending the fleeting moment. We may remind here that his favorite philosopher was Spinoza. And here on the right you have the Roman relief of Kairos, of this young angel or demon from the Roman Greek times. And it was found in Trogir, just near from here. Now it's in the Museum of Antiquities. It's the most famous sculpture relief of Kairos, which is another a Greek conception of time. Time is chronos, and Kairos is the fleeting moment, which is also a kind of door to the eternity, to the eternal time. Thank you for your attention.
Philip Grkić. Thank you very much for your very interesting talk. And much of what I'm going to say in my talk overlaps with what you have already said, so I'm going to repeat some of your arguments, including the discussion of the letter of condolence to the Besu family. I have just two small questions. First, do you think that there is any hope conciliation, so to say, between a theory or presentism with spatial theory of relativity? Because the main obstacle for accommodating a theory is the idea that, the presentist's insistence that there is a absolute simultaneity, which is the problem. And there are attempts, you quoted Zimmerman, but there is also a big two-volume book by William Lane Craig in which he wants to, in which he tries to reconcile A theory and presentism, so, and spatial theory. So do you think that there is any hope of reconciling these two doctrines? And another question, you classify yourself as an A theorist, right? And I understand why this is so, because you think, and I'm inclined to agree with this, that enigma of time should be looked for in consciousness. But I don't quite understand this last slide when you say that, well, we should take consciousness even more seriously, namely as the Platonic mind which emanates from the good. I understand the metaphysical aspect of that, but I don't understand the connection with the consciousness and time. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for both very good questions. So concerning the first question, if A theories are compatible with theory of relativity, A theories are compatible with relativity. Here I just follow Zimmerman, because it's not really so much my problem, my point here, because I would like to overcome this distinction between between A and B theories in another way, including consciousness into this story. So, but if I have to decide, as I said, I would be more inclined to A theories. Of course, the problem of consistency between A theories and relativity is a problem of simultaneity, which doesn't obtain in absolute simultaneity in relativity theory. You can cut the block of space-time in several slices, so you can. If you have two events, A and B, these two events in one simultaneity slice of the block universe, these two events are supposed to be, let's say, simultaneous, but in another cut of A is before B, and it depends of a reference frame, of course, and in the third one, B is before A, and so, but it doesn't mean the violating of the causality, because the signal from frame, let's say, S can't come early enough to the frame S1 to tell what happens in the future in that frame. But that's another story. So Zimmerman thinks yes, especially concerning this concept of moving now. And he said that also in Aristotle, you have, Aristotle speaks about both in his, already in his definition of time, he has a number and before and after, and in a sense, this before and after in Aristotle's sense is in somehow relative to the, nowadays we should say, to the reference frame of somebody's moving now. So that's a long story, a long of details here. I think it could be done. The other point is would need more clarification or more time, of course. I'm as a philosopher, I may say I'm Platonic or Neoplatonic or something like that. That's somehow a strange position today, I know. But it's not so very, very strange among philosophers, among logicians, for example, and among scientists like Roger Penrose, for example, is a Platonic. So it would need more explanation, but my main idea, because here you have two condensed, I agree, three different philosophical positions, Cartesian cogito, then Husserl's field of evidence of phenomena, and then Platonism, which traditionally they are in some opposition and so, and it's not very easy to see how these three positions could be connected in this context. Well, my point When I read the first time The Conscious Mind of David Chalmers, I was very, I agreed practically in all his points with him concerning the philosophy of mind, concerning the so-called heart problem, and so on, you know about that. But later, when I thought maybe a little more about this, I came to a kind of conviction or belief that this kind of dualism, which is present implicit or explicit in Chalmers' taking consciousness seriously, when on the other, on the one way you have cogito as a point which has no explication, which is the hardest problem of philosophy of mind, and on the other hand you have this, all these mental events and so on, which can be explained in the philosophy of mind. And this seems to me taking, at the end of the day, taking not seriously enough consciousness. Because in phenomenology and Husserl, I don't think that phenomenology has said the last word about, I'm quite conscious about the difficulties of phenomenology, about intersubjectivity, for example, and so on. It's about Lebenswelt, and so it's complicated. But here, if we compare taking consciousness seriously, if we take this syntagma of Chalmers, and if we compare Cartesian point, because cogito in meditation is just a point, archimedal point, let's say, figuratively, from which all the ontology is built. In Husserl's, it's not so. He speaks himself in his ideas, in his, and later in Cartesian meditations, about the field of evidence, transcendental field of evidence, and so on. And he develops these forms of consciousness. Eh? And how is this connection with Platonic mind? Well, here I'm afraid it's not enough time to elucidate this, but maybe just a hint. For me, in the famous analogy or allegory of the cave, the most important thing is that when this sage comes out of the cave to the sunlight, this feeling of not just sun as an object in the sky, as a ruler, let's say, or as a highest metaphysical point, but this impression of this overwhelming light. And this overwhelming light is a metaphor for the intellect, for the mind in Platonism. Because you couldn't say anything if you can have your eyes excellent, but if there's not light in the world, mind in the world, then you can't see anything. That's the main Platonic point, if we put aside other details, which are of course also important. And this is a kind of connection here that, if I may conclude just this, saying this, I have to stress again, my point is not to exclude, not at all to exclude physics. I'm a philosopher of science and I'm a philosopher of nature and so, and I'm doing these things, physics and so, from the philosophical point of view. But just to remind that physical approach to time is one of the approaches to time, and perhaps I'm knocking on the open door, so probably. But anyway, sometimes this very very simple and very basic thing is forgotten. That is, physics speaks about time in a special way, like a variable t. It can be, of course, several variables. It can be not only linear time in relativity and so on. It'd be parallel universes in quantum theory and so on. But anyway, it's a kind of reduction of the concept of time to physical purposes. And that's why it's not, from the point of philosophy, I think it's not quite enough.
Thank you, Tomislav.
Thank you. Well, I have one comment, one question. In fact, you already partly answered the question, but I'll still repeat it. The comment is concerning Einstein when you say that it is unusual for him that he was eternalism. Like you quoted his sentence that the time is just a permanent illusion, you know that. But I would say that it is not unusual for him because he was very much influenced, as you mentioned, by Spinoza, and Spinoza had such opinion. So that is really Spinoza's opinion which influenced Einstein to have, I would say, like that.
Yes,
I don't know.
I agree.
And another point is concerning, you partly answered it, concerning this many time repeated, the series of time, a certain order of events, and so on. What would you recommend, because even Einstein, what he found out in theory of relativity, that you have some events which you mentioned that, but you cannot put it in the sequence. It is not one, it depends on the reference frame, one which one is before another. So you have some events in time which you cannot put in that sequence.
Yes.
Would you comment on that? Yes, they are events, they are real events, but you cannot put them into that structure of before, now, and after, because they don't fit in, because in one reference frame, what is before is after.
There is no absolute reference frame, of course, but in a specified frame or selected frame, you can put the events into series. Yes, yes, that's. Yeah. Yes, that's true. That's not universal simultaneity is possible in relativity, of course. But the first question I would answer, yes, it's not so much a question of Einstein himself. He was also, a philosopher and a kind of eternalist, not only in this quotation, but even in his previous many speeches and so on. But I wanted to say that it's something very strange is maybe not a good term. It's something marvelous and something fine in this that in physics itself the idea of eternity comes out of such a consideration. But on the other hand, maybe it's not enough. Maybe it's not enough for really believing it. I'm skeptical if somebody can really believe in eternity following just this idea. This idea could help in, let's say, believing in eternity or in the distinction between past, present, and future. But that's maybe one of the ways to this belief. But
with Einstein, it originates with Spinoza.
Yes.
So it,
yes.
He was just propagating that idea. Sorry.
Scott Walter. Yes, just a quick response. I understood you claim that there's no absolute simultaneity in Minkowskian relativity. Well, that's true for 2 points, it's true for 3 points, it's not true for 4 points.
Yeah.
With four coplanar, non-co-hyperplanar points, you can define an absolute simultaneity between these four space-time points.
Mm-hmm.
So it's entirely possible.
Yes, but we are speaking here mainly about 2 points because deriving from the Aristotle definition of before and after, there's usually 2 points in the game here. So. From this point of view, I think that we can say that's not an absolute simultaneity between two events. Not, I'm not speaking about points in space-time. I'm speaking about events here. Yeah. Or points in space-time, yes. Yeah, that's the same practically.
From two
events, you find two more that are not compliant, and you have absolute space. You have an absolute simultaneity between any two events. Well, that's maybe, yes. I don't have an exact answer to your, it's more, not just a technical question, but it's a question. But usually speaking of relativity theory, it's always it is said that in relativity theory there is not absolute simultaneity of events. Okay, two events before and after. Before, yes. But you would agree that there's that's one of the points of the. of the critics of from the side of B theorists to A theorists, that A theory of time, coming from McTaggart, is not compatible just with relativization of simultaneity in relativity theory. So, well, yeah, I don't have an exact answer to your question, but mainly.
Nevin Bilic.
Thank you, Marko. I am a bit confused. I was following your question very carefully, and I tried to figure out to which category do I belong. And I would be very happy if you can answer me to this question, but I will give you my definition of time, and maybe then you can tell me who am I. Okay. The space-time, or let's say the universe, is a set of events, any events. I'm a point in a coordinate space that moves along the word line. My word line is time-like, which means that all the proper distances are squared, are greater than zero, so they are causally connected. So to me, I don't care about eternity or anything. The time is just the proper distance between my events. Who am I?
If you formulate the problem in this way, as you formulated it, in the moment, you are a theorist, because you are deriving from the conception of your own time-like world line, and you just glide in this or in this world line, and you put your identity in some moment on this world line of yours. But the point of B theorists is not to look this kind of perspective. It's to see the whole block universe, which is in its essence quite questionable, because there's no absolute frame to look at it and your personal world line would just be one of these world lines in the block universe. And that these B theorists say, well, where is some now here? If you look from this God's point of view, let's say, if you look from outside, well, there's no outside, we know, but if supposed you look at the block universe or timescape from the outside, and you say, here I see a lot of these world lines coming in several ways, and making a big net of time events and so on, then you are B theorists, and for the B theorists, there's no absolute now. And of course, this problem is also concerned or connected with the very definition of now. What is now? Is it just your personal now, or is our common now here? Because we are used that to think that the now, which is my now, it's also yours now, and his and hers, and so on. Because of proximity, because the speed between our bodies is not close to the speed of light, because there is a relatively weak gravitational field, and so on.
And Jean-Marc Levitt-Blum.
Yes, well, thank you very much for this talk. I enjoyed it quite a lot, and I agree fully with your conclusions. And I would like to add an argument to that effect. Indeed, it seems that most physicists think that time is their own time. And there is a sort of co-optation of the concept of time by physicists, which means that they'll try to answer the enigma of time only within physics. I think this is doomed to failure, as you pointed out very much. And the point I want to stress is that in most descriptions concerning the nature of time, there is a very strong relying on spatial analogies. As you yourself showed in your diagrams, block universes, spotlight, and so on, this is a kind of assimilation of time to space. In fact, that was of the main point in Bergson's book, Durée and Simultaneity, where he made some blunders, we remember, but we pointed that very clearly and very with much strength that if we can sometime describe some ideas related to time by spatial analogy, yet time is not space. And we have become so used to some diagrams where you put time axis, where we use ideas like word lines. But this is just a description. Time is much more and much more autonomous with respect to space than it is. So we should resist, and thank you for helping us, should resist this type of cooptation of the general idea of time by a physicist.
Thank you. You want to comment?
Thank you for your comment, and I quite agree with you. And of course, this spatialization of time is a problem. It's a philosophical problem, not so much physical problem, because physics do quite well with these diagrams, Minkowski diagrams and so on. But if you interpret it, if you interpret the fourth dimension, like the fourth space dimensions, that's a problem. It's not time, it's not a hyperspace. It's something different. And it's also interesting, that's another story, but it's interesting that in the theories of strings, you have this multiplication of space dimensions up to 9 or 10, and you have on the top only one time dimension remaining. And there are certain theorists like, well, there are like Stephen Hawking or somebody else who includes another dimension of time how is it the term, imaginative time or something like this. But these are more rare examples. The mainstream of thinking about space-time is also it's these theories of which Neven you began, Lida Ransel and so on about parallel universes. Well, the dimensions of time are going up to this compactified dimensions and so on. But there's practically no idea of compactified space, I wanted to say, time. That's maybe a kind of idea of this Kairos. Well, if there were time, I would speak also about, not just about Henri Bergson, but about Marcel Proust, which is one of my favorites, concerning time.
The biggest question is, do we have time to discuss more about time? It's such a nice question. I think we have some external constraints, and this is the coffee is going to be completely cold. If you can give extremely short questions, because Mirko Jakic, you renounced to your question. Or, no, you have a very short.
Very short. I disagree with McTaggart's conclusion. I think that he didn't create paradox of time. He created actually logical mistake, non sequitur, and I can explain it. But I have no time for this. I have article about that.
You want to comment or not?
Yeah, just a short answer. It's probably a mistake in McTaggart, in premises, and there are different opinions. Which of the three premises is wrong? Yeah.
That's okay, Dragan Poljak.
Just a quick question. You presented a nice review of the philosophical theories of time. You mostly tackled with linear time. So I would appreciate if you could address something related to philosophical theories of closed time-like curves, because we know that Kurt Gödel in 1949 obtained solutions for the rotating universe, and I'm interested what philosophy can say about it. Thank you.
I propose that again, my proposal is, if I may, that one of the meetings in the future would be about cosmology, and this type of problems also comes to closed time loops and Gödel and so on into cosmological research. Yes.
So we have to stop here, and we have now coffee break. You can take your coffee in the library, and we will start at 12:30.